In just a minute, we're going to take out our Bibles and we're going to look at Exodus chapter 3 and 4. If you want to start turning there, you may. I have a few things I want to kind of point out before we start reading here. We're talking about Moses today. We're starting a series on how we are qualified in Christ, how God qualifies us to serve Him in spite of any insecurities or inferiorities we might have. So we're going to look at Moses today. Moses really resisted God's call on his life. I just put Charlton Heston on there because perhaps many of you think of him when you think of Moses. Moses was, he was a hero in the whole Bible. As you read through the Bible, Moses' name comes up again and again. And I like the way Deuteronomy ends here. It says, "Since then," it's kind of like an obituary of Moses here, "since then no prophet has arisen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, who did all those miraculous signs and wonders the Lord sent him to do in Egypt, to Pharaoh and all his officials, and to his whole land. For no one has ever shown the mighty power or performed the awesome deeds that Moses did in the sight of all Israel." So Moses is, wow, this guy is the quintessential prophet and priest that we've ever seen because of all of the signs that he did and everything, the special relationship to God. It says he spoke with God face to face. In other parts of the Bible, it says you cannot see God and survive. That's too intense. But here it says Moses spoke with God face to face. He had that special connection with God. He knew God in a way that nobody else did. And this Moses, this great man of faith, was actually, though, he was at one time a man of pretty pathetic faith. He wasn't always this great man of faith. In fact, for 80 years of his life, he wasn't this great picture that was painted just yet. He was 80 years old when God called him. We're going to read this part now. Exodus chapter 3. Now Moses, 80 years old, was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the far side of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, "I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up." When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, "Moses, Moses." And Moses said, "Here I am." "Do not come any closer," God said. "Take off your sandals, for the place we are standing is holy ground." And he said, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. Again, because you cannot see God and live. The Lord said, "I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" And God said, "I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain." Moses said to God, "Well, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' Then what shall I tell them?" God said to Moses, "I am who who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name by which I am to be remembered from generation to generation. Go assemble the elders of Israel and say to them, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, appeared to me and said, I have watched over you and have seen what has been done to you in Egypt. And I have promised to bring you up out of your misery in Egypt into the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites, a land flowing with milk and honey. The elders of Israel will listen to you. Then you and the elders are to go to the king of Egypt and say to him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. Let us take a 3-day journey into the desert to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand compels him. So I will stretch out my hand and strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I will perform among them. After that, he will let you go. And I will make the Egyptians favorably disposed towards this people so that when you leave, you will not go empty-handed. Every woman is to ask her neighbor and any woman in her house for articles of silver and gold and for clothing, which you will put on your sons and daughters, and so you will plunder the Egyptians. Moses answered, what if they do not believe me or listen to me and say, the Lord did not appear to you? Then the Lord said to him, what is that in your hand? A staff, he replied. The Lord said, throw it on the ground. Moses threw it on the ground, and it became a snake, and he ran from it. Then the Lord said to him, reach out your hand and take it by the tail. So Moses reached out and took hold of the snake, and it turned back into a staff in his hand. This, said the Lord, is so that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has appeared to you. Then the Lord said, put your hand inside your cloak. So Moses put his hand into his cloak, and when he took it out, it was leprous, like snow. Now put it back into your cloak, he said. So Moses put his hand back into his cloak, and when he took it out, it was restored, like the rest of his flesh. Then the Lord said, if they do not believe you or pay attention to the first miraculous sign, they may believe the second. But if they do not believe these two signs or listen to you, take some water from the Nile and pour it on the dry ground. The water you take from the river will become blood on the ground. Moses said to the Lord, O Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue. The Lord said to him, who gave man his mouth? Who makes him deaf or mute? Who gives him sight or makes him blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, I will help you speak and will teach you what to say. But Moses said, O Lord, please send someone else to do it. Then the Lord's anger burned against Moses, and he said, what about your brother, Aaron the Levite? I know he can speak well. He is already on his way to meet you, and his heart will be glad when he sees you. You shall speak to him and put words in his mouth. I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. He will speak to the people for you, and it will be as if he were your mouth and as if you were God to him. But take this staff in your hand so you can perform miraculous signs with it. That's where we'll stop. So Moses, man of great faith, was at one time Moses, man of kind of pathetic faith, trying to get out of this assignment that God has given to him. Instead of trusting and following God, Moses makes excuses here. Quite a few of them. Two, but a lot of them. We make excuses too, don't we? When God calls us to do something, when we are asked to obey his commands, we find ways to get around it, to exempt ourselves and to say, well, that's not for me. I'm kind of exceptional, or that's a little too hard. I don't think I can pull that off. So you understand, right, God? Yeah, we make excuses. We find ways to avoid what God is telling us to do or to exempt ourselves from it. Let's take a look at a few things that some of these excuses that Moses gives here. In chapter 3, verse 11, he makes his first excuse. He says, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? Who am I? Me. I'm nobody, right? So I'm not the right person is his first excuse. There's other people who can do it better than me. There's not me. You got the wrong guy, God. This is not a job that I'm going to be good for here. And he has some reason to think that. I mean, he hasn't been among the Egyptians or the Israelites for 40 years. And he's kind of awkward among both groups. He doesn't really fit in well with the Israelites because he was raised an Egyptian, if you know this story there. And he doesn't really fit in with the Egyptians because he's actually an Israelite. So he doesn't really belong anywhere. And so actually, for the past 40 years, he's been living in Midian, and he married, he has some kids, he's settled down, he's got a nice job, and things are going pretty well for him. So he's got a good thing going there. Why mess with that? Lord, you got the wrong guy. I'm not in a good position to do what you're asking me to do here. Well, we don't need to be the right person for God to use us, do we? It doesn't matter who we are. God can use us. God can use anybody he wants for whatever he wants to do. We don't have to be the right person for the job. We don't have to be the most qualified person. We don't have to be in the best position. God can take any one of us and use us to do all kinds of stuff, however he likes. Maybe it's even because Moses has a foot in both groups of people that maybe he is actually very well suited for this assignment. He's grown up in Pharaoh's household, so he kind of knows the protocol there. And he is an Israelite, so he can call them his people. Maybe he's perfectly situated for that, even though he feels inadequate in both groups of people. In 3:13, he makes his next excuse. Moses said to God, "Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' Then what shall I tell them?" What am I going to do then, God? So excuse number two, they won't believe you sent me. So I'm going to go to them and I'm going to say, "Yeah, God sent me to you." And they're going to be like, no, not to you. Not you. Well, I mean, God has been silent for a while here. I mean, there's in the Bible story here, there's these gaps of time. God kind of enters the picture and then something great happens, but then there's some time in between here. God's kind of been silent for about 400 years. There hasn't really been a lot of revelations from God recently. And so now somebody just stands up and said, "Hey, God spoke to me." It'd be pretty easy to say, "Well, yeah, are you sure? Really?" I mean, anybody can just stand up and say, "Oh, God is speaking to me." But really? How do you know? What do you have for us that would prove that God is really speaking to you right now? It's easy to think that. And if you're going to be claiming that God is speaking something to you, what is it that God has to say to you? Well, and God says to him, "Let me tell you what my name is. I didn't reveal my name in this way to the people before. You know me as I'm the God of your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's how you know me. I'm going to give you a new way to reference me now." And he says, "I am who I am." When I was translating this passage, I kind of ran into something that I thought was kind of cool. If you look here in verse 12, God says, "I will be with you." In verse 14, he says, "I am who I am." And then in verse 15, it says, it has the word "Lord" in all capital letters there. That's whenever God's name appears in the Hebrew text, the original Hebrew, we have "Lord" in all capital letters in our Bibles. So that's kind of like code for this is where God's name appears. It's kind of a special name. When the Hebrew scribes were translating from, well, not translating, but if they were, the old text was kind of getting old and they were making a new one so that they could throw the old one away and have another one, they would wash their hands every time they wrote God's name because it was sacred. So when God's name appears in the text, that's like code for pay attention. God's doing something here. This is where God reveals his name to his people. I am who I am. In verse 12, when it says, I will be with you, and then in verse 14, I am who I am, those are the same words in Hebrew. When God reveals his name, there's a lot that you can pull out of God's name. It's a very rich word. But one thing that you can pull out of it, that God in his very name is a promise, I will be with you. It's the same word. God's name means, I will be with you. I'm not the God out there doing my own thing, just watching you from a distance. I'm the God who's right here with you. God is the one who is and will be with us. And that's embedded in who God is. That's his name. Moses continues with his excuses here. He's not done yet. He's got four of them to try to get out of it. So in chapter 4, verse 1, he has another excuse. He says, Moses answers, what if they do not believe me or listen to me and say, the Lord did not appear to you? We kind of covered that already, but he's throwing it out as an excuse again anyways. They won't listen to me is his third excuse. And Moses here gets a little aggressive, actually, if you kind of look at what he says here. There's one translation that I thought was pretty good. It says, look here, they won't trust me, and they won't pay attention to my report, for they will say, Yahweh has not appeared to you. So Moses is starting to get a little anxious and a little defensive with God here. Look, God, this isn't going to happen. They're not going to believe me. This isn't going to work. Well, just a few verses before that, God actually says to Moses, the elders of Israel will listen to you. When we're anxious, when we're kind of nervous, when we're kind of under pressure, our mind doesn't pick up everything it usually picks up because we're usually focused on something that we're worried about or concerned about. When we're highly anxious, we tend to focus on the wrong things. This is what's happening with Moses here. God says, the elders of Israel, they're going to listen to you. But Moses doesn't hear that. So he says, they're not going to listen to me. So that's his third excuse. God says, they will listen to you. They will. Here's some miracles that you can perform to prove that you're not just making this stuff up here. Moses has a fourth excuse. I am not a man of words. Chapter 4, verse 10. Moses said to the Lord, O Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither in the past, and I like this part, nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue. I am not a man of words, is what Moses said. I'm not somebody who speaks. I stumble. I'm not good at talking. And he even kind of has that little criticism of God here. Even since you appeared to me just now, I'm still not very good with my words here. It's not like you zapped me and suddenly I can speak well. Maybe you need to do that to me. A little bit of criticism of God there. I'm not a man of words. And I like what God says. Okay, you aren't a man of words, but who am I? Who gives people their mouths and who gives them the ability to speak? Isn't it me? The Lord? God? And then Moses has no more excuses. He gets the bare bottom of his motivation there. Chapter 4, verse 13. Moses says, Lord, please send somebody else to do it. In other words, God, I just don't want to. Okay, I don't have any more excuses. I just don't want to. And in the Hebrew it says, please send it by the hand of whomever you send. Just send that message by somebody else's hand. At the bottom of our every refusal of God is this. This isn't just Moses who's saying this. This is all of us too. Every time we refuse God, or we chicken out, or we don't do what he wants in one way or another, at the very bottom of all of our excuses is, I don't want to. I don't feel like it. And that's all we got. This is what sin is. This is actually the definition of sin, is this stubborn heart that we have. We don't want to follow God. We don't want to listen to him. We don't want to do what he says. It doesn't sound fun. It doesn't sound interesting. It sounds like it might be a little challenging. We don't feel like doing it. The essence of sin is this stubborn refusal to believe God, stubborn refusal to follow him. And that's in all of us. And as long as we're alive on this earth, we got to struggle against that. We got to be paying attention to, okay, how am I just saying no to God here? That's something we all have to pay attention to. It's called original sin. When Adam and Eve sinned, then all of us, we are now broken. So from the moment we're born broken. We're unable to respond to God like we were supposed to in the beginning. Jesus is about fixing us. That's what redemption is. We talked about that a lot. If you have Christ, there is no excuse for not obeying. Christ is our redemption. He's the one who heals our hearts, who fixes our minds, who opens our eyes and opens our ears, and so we should be able to get it now. We still find ways to make excuses. We still have some stubbornness in there, and that's what we call, a fancy word for that is sanctification. We're being continually renewed into God's image, the full image of God, following Jesus Christ. But we have a God that can do all things, and he equips us to do everything that he calls us to do. So if God gives us a command, he enables us to follow that command. If he calls us to do something, he gives us the power to do it. Even if we don't have that power in ourselves, we will have that power when it comes time to do it. When God commands, he equips. We all face temptations to not do what God wants us to do. But listen to what 1 Corinthians 10 says. No temptation has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. We don't have any excuses, really. We do have that I don't want to. And that's our problem. But if we have Christ, we are enabled to do everything that we are called to do. We don't have any excuses. When God calls us to do something, he also qualifies us to do it. Moses here, not a guy who would, he at least in his mind, not a guy who would be good for this assignment. But the point is not what Moses can do or what he can't do. The point is what God can do. And God is trying to get through to Moses, hey, maybe you aren't good enough, but I am. And even if you feel inadequate, that doesn't mean that I can't use you. So listen to me. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to give you words to say. I'm going to give you power to perform miracles. This is going to work. Start going. Lord, please send somebody else to do it. But when God calls us, He qualifies us. He gives us what we need. I've mentioned this before, but when I was first starting to seriously consider ministry and being a pastor, I was somebody, I had plenty of excuses to make here. I'm a horrible public speaker. And that was definitely the case in my high school speech class. I was definitely the worst. I was the one who was shaking the most when I was delivering even my final speech. And there are parents who have come up to me since then and said, how in the world did you become a pastor? I still remember you in that first speech class there. I was not a good public speaker. When you go into ministry, you have to learn Hebrew and Greek. Those are some pretty tough languages. I was terrible at Spanish. I got C's and D's in Spanish. Those are the worst grades in my entire college career. How am I going to, if Spanish has a lot of overlap with English, if I did that bad in Spanish, how am I going to do Greek and Hebrew? I'm very thin-skinned and sensitive also. When you're a pastor, you gotta be able to take some criticism and stuff, you know? And how am I going to handle that? I had plenty of excuses to say, Lord, just send somebody else to do it. But I can tell you personally that when God calls you to do something, He equips you to do it. That public speaking thing, I got better at that. The more I did it, the easier it became. I got C's and D's in Spanish. I got A's and B's in Greek and Hebrew. I don't know how that happened. God made it happen. And this thin skin thing, yeah, I'm still kind of thin skin, but there have been times when God's given me thick skin. And He's also given me a great congregation where I don't have to deal with the criticism a whole lot. So, thanks, by the way. So, I can tell you, personally, when God calls us to do something, He equips us to do it. We might not be qualified in ourselves, but we're qualified in Christ. I just want to encourage you that if God calls you to do something, He's going to let you do it. Somehow. No matter how many doubts you might have about yourself. Actually, every one of our doubts is an occasion for God to prove Himself and grow our faith. Whenever we have doubts, I don't know if God's going to be able to do that, or I don't think this is going to happen the way that God said it would. Every one of those times, that's an opportunity for us to be like, whoa, God is real after all. He really does answer prayer. I didn't think He would, but He really does. Now, that's different than testing. God will prove Himself, but there's a difference between testing God and letting Him prove Himself. Testing God is to try to force God's hand somehow. So when Jesus was being tempted by Satan, and Satan said, why don't you throw yourself off from the highest point of the temple? Because it says in the Bible, angels will lift you up and then you won't be injured. If Jesus were to have done that, that would be to like try to force God's hand. So if you and I were to jump off a cliff and say, God, if you're really there, you're going to catch me. That's us testing God. That's like trying to force His hand. And that's not right. But if there is somebody sick and we think, I don't know if God's going to heal that person. Or if we have something that we have to do today and we're a little nervous about it, I don't know if God's going to be there for me. And we pray about it and things turn out great. There's an opportunity where God is just said, hey, I'm really here. You know, you kind of think that I'm not here, but I really am. God doesn't call us to do the same things necessarily. He puts us all in different situations. He gives us different gifts. He gives us different opportunities. But He does call all of us to obey Him. We read some of those commands a little bit ago. Those aren't just for some of us. Those are for all of us. Those aren't just for, you know, once in a while or when you feel like it. That's for all always. We get caught up a lot in what God's plan is for my life. You know, what job am I supposed to have? Who am I supposed to marry? That kind of stuff. But the most important things are the ones that are the most straightforward. So those are the ones that we just read about. And I have a bunch of other ones to throw on the screen here for you to think about here. Pretty straightforward stuff. This is for all of us, all the time. Matthew 6:31, you can put that up there. Do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Don't worry. Even about the stuff that you need. Don't worry about that. It's pretty straightforward. Luke 6:35, let's look at that one there. Love your enemies, do good to them, and lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Pretty straightforward. Pretty tough to do, but it's pretty plain. 1 Corinthians 6:18, flee from sexual immorality. Honor God with your body. That can be tough to do, but it's pretty straightforward here. Romans 12:12, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. That's hard, but it's pretty straightforward. God equips us to do it. Ephesians 4:25, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor. We have to be honest with each other, not just when we feel like it, but all the time. This is what God calls us to do. Philippians 4:4, this one kind of rubs me the wrong way. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Not a lot of qualifications there. It's even repeated. There's a lot of times I don't feel like rejoicing. But that's what it says. Colossians 3:13, bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. It's really hard to do that, especially when somebody has hurt us very deeply. But there it is. Hebrews 13:5. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have. That's hard. Especially living in the society that we're in, where we're constantly being told that you need more and more things all the time. But this is what it says. James 1:19. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Pretty straightforward. Romans 13:14, kind of a general command here. Clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the sinful nature. These are our commands. These are the most important things. If one job or another, you know, God's will for you, you know, could be a couple different things maybe. Who you marry, you know, you might be able to get along with person A or person B. Not as important as this stuff. The most important stuff is the stuff that's the most straightforward, the most clear, the most direct. We kind of have a hard time with this stuff, don't we? We need to be reminded of it. And as hard as it is, God equips us to do it. We can't make excuses. We can't be like Moses. We might have that, I don't want to. That's real, but there's our challenge. And one more thing. He calls us all to be witnesses, to testify about who he is. Matthew 28:19, make disciples of all nations. Command. 1 Peter 3:15, always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have, and do this with gentleness and respect. We need to be able to explain to people why Jesus Christ means as much as he does to us. I mean, unless he doesn't, unless he's no big deal, unless you're just a Christian incidentally, or is he the best thing that's ever happened to you? We're called to be witnesses. Now, we could say, you know, I'm not the right person. There's somebody who probably needs to know Christ in my life, but I'm not the right person to talk to them. I'm not a person of words. I don't really know what to say. They won't listen to me. We can throw all of Moses' excuses out there. But if God puts somebody in our life who needs to know about Christ there, and he tells us, go and witness, go and make disciples of all nations, be prepared to give an answer, he's going to give us words to speak. And even if we're really inadequate in our words, he can use those words. Instead of making excuses, remember, God can use even me. That's what Moses needed to remember. And that's what we need to remember too. God can use even me. Not because I'm so great or because I can do it, but because God can do anything. And if he commands us to do something, he will equip us to do it. Let's look at the screen here together. What is the third request of the Lord's Prayer mean? Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven means help us and all people to reject our own wills and to obey your will without any backtalk. Your will alone is good. Help us one and all to carry out the work we are called to as willingly and faithfully as the angels in heaven. Let's pray. Lord our God, we pray this day that your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven, and not just for other people, but in each one of our lives too. Please soften our hearts so that we submit to you, that we listen to you, and that we do what you ask us to do, not because we are so special or because we are so able, but because you are our God and that you go with us. Remind us of that always. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.